Hi, everybody. Ritu is joining us shortly. Hi.
Hello.
Hi, how are you?
Very well, Tanya.
Yeah, so you can hear me, I'm fully clear.
Sorry, there's some voice problem. Can you come again?
I said, can you hear me and see me clearly?
Yes, I can hear you and see you clearly.
Okay, great. So we'll just start in a couple of minutes. I think people are still joining in.
Until
I'm going to quickly introduce you, although there's no introduction really needed. Everybody knows who you are, but I'll still introduce you. So Ritu Khandelwal is a co-founder of Sthapatya Architects, a Jaipur-based architectural interior design firm established in 1996. Sthapatya is a bespoke luxury design firm that tailors intuitive, inventive, and timeless solutions for clients. They believe in orchestrating the senses, interplaying visual elements, and creating distinct and irreplaceable experiences. Ritu has been deeply involved in art and culture, and I believe you have an immense fondness for poetry and Indian classical music. So her initiative has also taken form in an event called 9.Square, which is a catalyst to let the Indian treasure of art and craft be valued and used in the modern day design language. She's recognized as one of the most innovative professionals in the city with many landmarks. Joining us today, we'll be talking about how stone is a key attribute of interior design. And our format is that we'll quickly run over two questions. We'll spend about 15-20 minutes talking about the theme, and then we'll open up the forum to the audience and people who are watching.
Sure.
So my first question is, how, according to you, and in your sort of extensive work experience, how do you feel that stone plays an important role in interior design and architecture?
Yes, so of course, stone is the most, one of the most important components in interior design and architecture. And a lot of times clients ask me that at what stage will you tell us what marble to procure? Okay. And what I tell them is that, see, the first stage is marble, because only with marble I start my design. And it's true. It's not because I'm here and talking about stone, but it's the truth that I start my design with marble. Because marble has, marble is in two ways useful to us. One is it is utilitarian. It's fine. You have to do floors or whatever, toilets, kitchens in stone. And second is it's luxury component. It's design component. So now if you make a mood board in your office, which says that you want a gray marble. Now you go to the yard and you find no gray marble, which is like a good quality stuff, but you find a brown, which is really good. Or you find a black and white, which is really good. So what do? You change your mood accordingly. So what I do is, I first go and hunt for marbles. And I look at the marbles with an absolutely open mind. I don't close my mind as to, okay, this is my mood board, and therefore I reject this and I take this. And I look at all the marble with, with all my heart and what we like. And there itself, I, in my mind, create a mood board. I sometimes Google and tell my clients, see, look at this mood board. So they can't imagine the marble, but when I show them the mood board, they like the marble. This is a good way to, buy. Okay, let's go for this. So to me, marble is a very important part in my design. And also what happens is that, there are plain marbles, there are colored marbles, there is white marble, there is this some kind of texture. Then not just marbles, if I talk of stone, then there are various sandstones available. We are like so rich in sandstones. India is extremely rich in stones. So we have textures. We have to harness all those qualities in our interiors and architecture. You know, sometimes we pick a marble because of its color, because it adds color to a interior space. Sometimes we only use it for a texture on a wall. You know, maybe the floor is wooden, maybe the floor is some other material, and then we use marble only in an accenting way, and we don't use it as the main material. So one thing that, you know, I think we need to understand is that, you know, people feel that it's really expensive to buy good marble. So we'd rather go for tiles or any painted stuff. So, you know, my take on this is that marble is a natural material. So all materials that are natural have their value. So why do we wear diamond and not like a American diamond? Why do we wear a solitaire and we don't use AD and there's no value? Otherwise, the glitter is the same. There's no difference in the glitter. But yet people spend, you know, lakhs and crores on on solitaires. That's because it's natural. It's invaluable. The same is the case with stone. Stone are sedimentary or maybe igneous rocks that come out of the earth. So they are valuable. They're extremely valuable. So wood and stone, these are the two natural materials that we use in our architecture and interiors. And therefore, they are very important. And therefore, their usage is also very important. That how do we use it? You know, like, so there are times when you want to really create luxury with marble. So you could use it extensively, a very figured material on the floor, but then one has to keep silent carpets over it, you know, monochrome furniture over it, because then you want to just highlight the, you know, grandeur of marble. But there are times when you don't want to do that. There are times when you want to really play with the colors of the carpet and you want really accent colors on the walls. It's then that you go for neutrals. But, you know, I feel that the choice of color at the first place of the marble, one should have a fair idea of where one is wanting to go. And marble doesn't, any stone doesn't happen only in floorings and walls. You could just place like a nice lampshade made out of marble or a marble statue or just a marble table. Now, there are so many ways to use marble. So, yeah, I do experiment a lot with stones and create the magic that we want to.
Okay, so what are the, I mean, of course, it's a very sort of, you know, there's no real right answer, no specific answer to it. But what are the type of stones that you like to work with and you think work well, especially in the context and climate that we live in, right? You know, stone is a very versatile material, like you've also said. How do you think one can use stone for different surfaces, horizontal as well as vertical?
Yeah, so like I said, you know, like the context of using marble is different in warm climates and it's different in the cold climates. So, of course, stone by nature is a cold material and it gets very cold. So, therefore, in colder climates, what they do is they use marble maybe in a fireplace or, you know, they would use marble on a tabletop or maybe on a column cladding just to sort of delineate spaces. But in tropical climate like ours, we use marble more extensively because we are dusty and we are warm here and we like to have cold interiors. I mean, not exactly cold interiors, but we like the coolness of the marble, I would say. In spite of getting a warmth into a space, we want coolness into our environment. So yes, here in the tropical climates, the stone is much more used than in warm countries. You know, warm countries, they use it very, very little and very judiciously, and they only use accent points in marble. But here, marble is our utility. In tropical climate, marble is a utility. So,
good point. Yeah.
So, if where you are placed in time and place, I mean, you know, which country, which climate. And then also another thing is that I feel another thing that happens in the market, I mean everywhere when I see, that people think that just by using a very, very expensive or sathwari or something, you know, anything like that you use, and yes, it'll be a statement of richness. But trust me, that's not true, because it all depends on how you put together the story. So the way you put together the story matters, whatever the marble. So it's your decision that you will take a silent marble, and would you do inlays in it, or would you create patterns in it, or you would create, you only want a natural material which will show for itself. So it's a call that the designer has to take always. And I take this call every time I do an interior. So, you know, normally when I'm doing some traditional interiors and where I can use patterns on the floor, I can use, you know, I can create carpets and floor itself. That time I take less figured material. Of course, nice colors, but I look at lesser figures. But if I'm creating something really modern, at that point, I know that, you know, no steel putties and no inlays and nothing would go. So at that time, I use marble in its natural form. Just wall-to-wall, lay the background of the interior. And one thing that I do take care of a lot is that I use a or theory. So it's floor or the wall or the accent. Okay, everything can't be marble.
Right.
So it can happen that you use a different sandstone on the wall and you use the marble, which is nicely polished, and you sort of contrast it with some rough surface on the wall, or you contrast it with some darker color on the wall, but of any stone. But you can't use the same type of, same genre of marble everywhere in an interior.
Right.
If that is done, then you'll lose the whole, you know, effect of it.
Also, you can create impact through uniqueness, right? If you use too many materials, then obviously that gets, the impact gets lost.
So,
like I was asking, what are the stones that you like to sort of work with?
So,
whether it's
honestly,
to create simple
materials. Yeah, I'll tell you. Honestly, I don't have like a really tone, specific tone, because my interiors are really varied. Very varied. I do very varied work. You know, my aesthetics go from here to there, you know, all over the place, because I have clients with various choices. So, yeah, I mean, I do like the grey beige family a lot, because, you know, they are so neutral that you can do anything over it. But I also like a lot of medium tones. I go lesser for the darker tones, because I feel I want to leave that to wallpapers or walls or carpets or stuff like that. I reach the medium tone, but I do love figures in the marble. So my way of choosing stone is always looking at what is pleasant to the eye in terms of figure and color. But yes, I'm not too used to using very dark colors in the marble.
Okay, very interesting. You have worked a lot in the luxury home segment, right? How does stone add value or contribute to visual impact, you know, in such projects?
Completely. Like it really adds value to the interior vocabulary of a space. You know, so I have done a few classical homes. Mm-hmm. And so there was a point of time when I was doing two classical homes, both heavily European and classical. Okay. But one was, the whole house was in beige, and the other had all the exotic varieties, you know, that were available. You know, with exotic onyxes and exotic other marbles that we put. Because if you see that, you know, like all the Italian villas, the Versailles, you know, the Palace of Versailles, if you look at it, even like the columns are beautiful figured green onyx columns that they have, iconic to everyone. So the figures and the colors of any marble has a great impact on the interior. Great impact. And you can actually pick up your color scheme because they have such varied colors in it that you can actually pick up your color scheme from one of the colors. So a lot of time I do that. My mood board, the marble, goes with me everywhere when I go to select fabric, when I go to select carpets, everything, that marble piece goes with me. And you know, like, even if it has like a tinge of orange, I just pick up that orange and blow it off in another thing.
Yeah.
And otherwise, that marble, nobody would notice that orange. But the moment you complement that color elsewhere, people start noticing that. And then they say, oh, what matching is this? But that's how you have to, that's how I use the figures of marble in the interiors. And that's how it makes an impact in the overall vocabulary of any interior.
That's very interesting, you know, what you say, because it's almost like the marble or the stone becomes a design element, right? It's, yeah. It's a design determinant. It's going to drive how the design outcome will be.
Of course. To me, it does. To me, it does. Yeah.
So, okay, that's really interesting. So I was asking you earlier, you know, while designing spaces, what are the factors that define your choice of stone? You know, what are the different aspects that you consider?
So, you know, the factors, see, the first factor is, of course, budget. So I do ask my client that, see what the budget is like. And if the parameter is like, he's given me a parameter that, see, my expenditure can't go beyond this. So between that slab, I focus on between that slab. So one parameter is, of course, the cost, the expenditure ability of the client. Then second factor is whether your interior is a contemporary interior, it is a classical interior, it's a modern interior. What can, it's a retail space, it's a hospitality space, it's a residential interior. What exactly is it? The usage. Like I tell you, suppose it's a hospitality segment lobby that you're doing. Now, you can't be putting an onyx on the floor. You can't be putting this burden of maintenance to the client. So that time you have to think that, okay, what is it that he will be able to maintain well and yet my vocabulary completes, or the story of my interior completes. So it's very important to understand that what cost bracket, then for whom are you selecting? What is like your style of interior that you're doing? And then lastly, of course, I mean, what you like when you go, what is pleasing to the eye? So, and even the maintenance factor. So there are, see, marble has a huge number of qualities coming from all across, from India. There's so many. And you can hardly make out what is what, you know, if it is presented, half the people can't even make out what marble is what. But there are some brittle marbles. There are some marbles with very thin grains. We call it pocher. I don't know if you know the word pocher, but pocher is the grains of the marble. So, jitna uska pocher barik hota hai, utna marble acha hota hai. Then watermarks, whether it has watermarks, whether it has cracks. You know, so you have to evaluate whether it is. So, why you can there are some marbles which don't take polish well. So, they might use 2 months of, you know, the client has entered, the polish will go. So all this you have to see when you buy marble. It's not just visual. As an architect, I'm supposed to tell my client exactly what is good for him and what is not good for him. So sometimes it does happen that, you know, some color, we're stuck on some color and I feel that the quality is not good. Or sometimes the quality is very good, but, you know, the visual impact is not so much. So at that time, you have to weigh your decision as to what you need.
Can you share tips for, you know, because we have other architects and other designers also on you know, as a part of the audience. How do you think one decides? I mean, what are the two or three things that one must sort of take care of when picking out a stone?
So one must take care of is, of course, the quality of its brittleness. I mean, it shouldn't be very brittle because otherwise it'll keep cracking, or you know. So the brittleness of the marble, you have to see that it hardness and brittleness are two different things. So it has to be hard, but it has to be lesser brittle. So one is this, and secondly, of course, they have to take care of their interiors and color scheme and all that. That is another thing that they have to take care of. And third, the budget. I mean, that's it. Quality, looks, and budget.
Yeah.
These are the three things.
Thank you. So you have this belief that, you know, variety is the key to success, right? So
yes.
Would you sort of share some tips with our audience on how they can play with different varieties of stone and the sort of, you know, and design variety as well? You know, how to design contemporary spaces today using the variety of materials that is available to us?
Yeah, of course. Because see, now the Indian market and the Indian manufacturers, they've done such beautiful R&D over the past, you know, 4 or 5 years, that there are various kinds of machines available, all the laser cut machines and CNC and this and that, all the texturing machines, and they are doing wonders with Indian stones. So they are creating river stone effects, they are creating leather patterns, they are creating various 2D cut patterns, you know, stuff like that. So with the marble that you select, there is this whole gamut of stone available to you in terms of sandstones, quartzites, artificial marble, all this is available to you. So you can play a lot with this. You can play a lot with this, and you should. You should, because stone is like once put for a lifetime, it's put, it's zero maintenance, and it will always be there. So you will cherish it all your life.
Yeah, I think as designers, we have the opportunity to leverage the ways and the diversity that is available to us. So it's just
yes.
How much we sort of choose to leverage those, you know, options that are available.
Yeah, and see, it's a fine balance. You can't do it all in stone. It's a very fine balance that every designer has to decide himself, that how much to use stone, how much to use other materials.
Other materials, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, well, this has been really interesting, Ritu. I would also like you to, you know, just be following the hashtag of Let's Talk Design, right?
Yes.
And that theme around which all of these conversations are based. So would you like to share, you know, the one thing that you want to say for Let's Talk Design?
So I want to say for Let's Talk Design that stone is a non-renewable source available to us. We have to use it respectfully. So, you know, like for every designer, when they use stone, they have to respect it and put it respectfully, not overdo, not underdo, but they have to use it really respectfully. Respect for stone is very, very important. You know, we are mining and taking it out of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my advice to Let's Talk Design.
Very, very valid point. Thank you. Also, if you know, a lot of questions are, you know, people have, even as designers, sometimes we don't know stone well, and there are enough myths between clients and architects and designers, right? So if there was one myth that you had to bust about stone, what would that be?
So I think one myth is that the more stone you use, the better the interior looks. So I, like I said earlier, the ore theory, I mean, everyone has to remember the ore theory, that stone ore, it's so stone on floors or walls.
Right.
Artifacts can't be all.
Yeah, very, very good point. I think we maybe actually, because I think that really sums up what your views on stone are. And obviously, you know, in your experience, I think if you've applied it and tested this theory out, it obviously is something that can, you know, work well for others too. So I'm going to now just quickly take up some questions that we have from the audience. Somebody's asked if sandstone is a good option on facades.
Yes, sandstone is a very good option on facade, but there are various varieties of sandstone which you need to understand. So there are softer ones and there are a little harder ones. So you know, you've got to choose the harder variety one, and if at all you need to choose the softer variety, one is please dry clad it and don't clad it directly with just cement or adhesive, because that creates a problem, because the water goes in and then, you know, like there are seepage problems and the joints come out and then the stones start falling off. So right. Always dry clad it if you have to do it in the exterior use, and try and use the harder variety like the Bhutpura, the Kota region, you know, or maybe Lalitpur mint or Kandla gray. I mean, there are some stones which are relatively harder than the other ones. So you have to choose between them. And of course, use sealants. Now sealants are available. So please use sealants, because then that will protect your stone from showing water marks and from, you know, taking stains and dirt. So these, I think, two things if you consider, you can easily use stones.
So you also, I mean, you work out of Jaipur, and you know, there's a lot of climate, extreme climate change, you know, that the north region of India sort of faces. What are the people to maintain stone?
So see, maintenance of interior stone is absolutely no problem with the, even with the temperature variation. So the interior stone is fine. I mean, if you use marbles. But yeah, I would recommend that if you use, say, in outdoor terraces or any kind of driveways or stuff like that, if at all you're using stone and not ceramic, then go for granites, because granite is an extremely tough stone and, you know, nothing will happen with climate on it. So you could use that on horizontal surfaces, and vertical you can use whatever. You just have to clad it properly. The problem is if there are grooves, and if the stone can breathe, it will never fall off or break or crack. It needs to breathe.
Okay, we also have this question that keeps coming up. What is your, I mean, you said earlier that, you know, there's not one favorite stone. But if you had to identify with a stone and its personality, what would that one stone be?
Oh, this I did not think.
It's really more to do with you. It's not to do with the projects. You know, as a designer, what is the one stone that you feel very strongly reflects your, you know, who you are as a designer?
Yeah, so I'll tell you, in Indian stones, in my earlier times, like in the first few years of my practice, I did use Makrana White. And we used to get Makrana White 15 years back, good lots. And so I used to love that stone, because the more you walk on it, you know, the better it gets day by day. However, since it's not available now, I love Michelangelo. So I use that quite a bit in my interiors. I love it. It's light colored. It's like really like it's very, it has... It almost feels there's water over it. It takes polish well, and it doesn't go bad after years. It doesn't have cracks. It's a good material.
Of its own. Yeah, I think it has a personality of its own.
Yeah. So I like it.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Ritu. I think this has been very, very insightful. And I think this session, you know, it's also going to go on the HR's IGTV. So it's there for everybody to sort of learn from. Even people who missed the session can go back and sort of, you know, learn from your expertise. Thanks a lot. And, you know, thank you just for being a part of this journey with us.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Thanks a lot.